so we have now Susanna Terracini presenting Parabolic Trajectories and Symbolic Dynamics, a survey on the variational approach to the n-body and n-centered problem. Again, 5 minutes when you have only 5 minutes.
Thank you. So first I would like to warmly thank the organizers for this very nice opportunity, for giving me the opportunity of coming here once again to the CEMEC meeting. Okay, so I'm going to report about some recent and less recent results about parabolic trajectories and their role in the variational approach to the n-body and n-centered problem. Okay, this is a very optimistic outline of this talk. I will probably arrive maybe here, but not. Well, okay. So, what are our motivations? Our motivation is try to understand the complex motion in the sense of non-trivial dynamical structure in a system of differential equations which is governed by strongly non-linear interaction, and this is the case of the n-center on n-body or problems, and in general all differential systems coming from Celestial mechanics. Okay, and then so we would like to set up methodologies which work in cases when the interactions are important, are the prevailing mechanism. The equations are very far from being solved explicitly and are also very far to be perturbations of simpler systems. Okay. So we try to study some selective trajectories and some ways of gluing them, of pasting them, of combining them in order to obtain more complex motions. Well, the most simple solutions, I'm not going to elaborate on that, are relative equilibria of central configurations. And then I will build on parabolic solutions, that connect two given central configurations. Central configurations are in fact the configurations of the simplest possible parabolic solution, the relative equilibrium. And then I will try to use these parabolic solutions. Parabolic solutions are zero energy solutions. Zero energy solution, trying to build periodic solution shadowing concatenations of parabolic arcs, and then also non-periodic solutions. Okay, and the statement I'm going to discuss, one of these final statements, is density of periodic solutions and about the occurrence of chaos. There are other very interesting aspects which could be in the end of an analysis, when you are able to perform this program, and then you have many periodic solutions, and you can associate to each periodic solution a Morse index and some other quantity related with the action spectrum, and combine them in a formula like in Goodfiller theory. Which can be also associated to features of the associated Schrödinger operator, but I'm not going to elaborate on that also because we don't have any result on that. Okay, let me start with the n-centered problem. N-centered problem is a very classical problem when you can consider that of the n-body plus one and plus one body problem, and our major muscles, which are mainly fixed, and only the last one, the last particle can move. So we have N fixed center of attraction, C1, Cn, and then we consider homogeneous potentials of some degree, minus alpha, and alpha will be a number between 1 and 2, which includes the gravitational case. And now I'm going to talk about the three-dimensional space, and then I will discuss the main difference with the two-dimensional case. The three-dimensional case is more difficult. Okay, so we have a potential, which is just the sum of the attraction potentials of each center, and then the collisions, this is of course a singular potential with a number of singularities, and we will call it the collision set. And then the motion equations, Newton's motion equation, we can imagine that the last particle has unit masses. Mass is has this form. Okay, this is a Hamiltonian system. The Hamiltonian is just the sum of the kinetic and the opposite of the potential. So, and we are interested in zero energy trajectories. The trajectories we are interested in will have a prescribed ingoing and outgoing directions. Okay, so our problem is we fix one pair of ingoing and outgoing direction, and we seek a parabolic solution, a zero energy solution, which has these two as asymptotic directions. Okay, and in the n-body problem, I will elaborate on this in a moment, parabolic trajectories, especially minimal parabolic trajectories connecting two minimal central configurations, minimal in the sense of the potential energy, are structurally unstable, cannot be found. They are not there. However, they may play a fundamental role in the description of the dynamics, and they can be used as a very cheap metro network for connecting different parts of the configuration of the phase and the configuration space. Okay, and I will try to convince you that this can also be connected with the existence of minimal collision trajectories, and here with minimal now I mean minimal action, or minimal the sense of Jacobi length, the detection of abundant families of non-collision periodic orbits, and some application of the weak cam theory in celestial mechanics, in particular the some solutions of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation. Okay, so let me start with a simple statement. We take the problem I stated before. We give two asymptotic configuration, and we assume that they are not equal, and then there exists a spatial parabolic trajectory with no collisions with the centers, which has some definite behavior at infinity in the sense of the distance from the origin and also the velocity, and has these two configurations as limiting normalized configurations. Okay, now what happens when the two are equal? The statement still holds true, but there could be a collision with one of the centers. Okay, now we can look at this statement in the light of scattering Okay, we define the scattering angle as the one between the outgoing and the ingoing direction. Okay, so now our theorem states the existence of one parabolic trajectory for every scattering angle. Okay, this is not trivial. Oh, okay, I forgot to say to point out that in this theorem, n must be larger or equal than 2, because for one fixed center, this theorem is false. And in fact, when we have only one center, there is only one scattering angle allowed, and this depends only on the degree of homogeneity of the potential. Okay, while for parabolic trajectories, while for hyperbolic trajectories, you will have hyperbolic positive energy solutions that have every prescribed behavior at infinity. Okay, so we are recovering through the existence of many bodies a property which, of many centers, a property which will be false in the case of one, only one center. And this also, this marks a striking contrast with the positive energy case compared with the zero energy case in the one centered case. Okay, and then let me now put the result in comparison zone with what happens in the planar case. In the planar case, you can prove very easily the same statement. But you can even prove a more a stronger result. Okay, when you have many centers on the plane, then you can look at trajectories which come from infinity, if you want, having some prescribed direction, and then go back to infinity with another one, and have some topological property with respect to the centers, okay? So, for example, you can it's rather easy to see that if this trajectory has some minimality property with respect to the Jacobi length, for example, so a geodesic, a minimal, locally minimal geodesics with respect to the Jacobi length, then cannot have self-intersections, okay? And then you can see that it will cut the centers in two sets. Let's assume that they are both non-empty. And then in the two-dimensional case, the question is, given a partition of the centers and two asymptotic directions, is there a parabolic trajectory that cuts the centers in these two prescribed subsets? And well, the answer is yes. And then in this case, we have not only one parabolic trajectory, but many parabolic trajectories, each for every non-trivial partition of the center. Okay, and then these parabolic trajectories, parabolic arcs, can be used, I will elaborate on this in a moment, in concatenation to prove the existence of periodic trajectories that correspond to sequences of symbols where the symbols are the possible partitions of the set of center. And this this is a way of exploiting topological non-trivial property of trajectories to build symbolic dynamics. In the three-dimensional case, well, we see two major difficulties compared with the two-dimensional case. The first is that one doesn't expect the parabolic arcs to be minimals of the Jacobi matrix. This is somehow related also with the fact that the central configuration, planar central configuration in three dimensions are not minimized. So you always, you can always cook a vertical variation that makes the length decrease. So the first is to pass from minimal to non-minimal trajectories. And the second is that you cannot relate one single trajectory to a definite homotopical property. So you cannot say in three dimensions that one single trajectory separates the center in any possible way. So from the two to the three-dimensional case, you lose both minimality and possibly existence, and the topological characterization of the trajectories. And there is if we stay in for one more moment into the case, the two-dimensional case with one center, then one can make some interesting remark. In the two-dimensional case, trajectories or parabolic trajectories are they are not explicit, but they are you can easily characterize them. And what happens is that when the angle when the exponent alpha is larger than one, strictly larger than one, then the parabolic arcs intersect themselves, also in two dimensions. And then also in two dimensions. And then this means that, first, already in two dimensions, they are not anymore global minimizers for the length. They may be local minimizers. And one can relate the Morse index, so the number of directions, the Morse index of the Jacobi length or the action, with this looping and the occurring for alpha larger than one, and there is a relation that was first established by Kazunaga Tanaka with a change in the Morse index of the parabolic solution. Okay, so now we use alpha as a parameter to get a better understanding of the nature of this parabolic solution. Okay, and in fact there is also a relation with of the Morse index, which will be non-trivial, with the absence of presence of collisions. Okay, we know that for the Kepler case, the minimality of the trajectory will, with topological constraint, will avoid the presence of collisions. In the three-dimensional case, this would still be true, but our trajectories are not minimal anymore, and so one has to build some theory of result about that relates the presence of collisions with a Morse index which is non-trivial. Okay, so let me say let me spend a few words. How do you prove this, the theorem? Well, the proof is somehow is simple. You just consider an approximating problem. You take a very, very large sphere of radius r. You take r times the ingoing and outgoing directions. You try to solve in some interval, time interval, the problem, a Bolzha problem, a fixed end problems. And then you try to pass r, the radius of this big sphere, to infinity. And then you have to prove that these structures goes to infinity, is strong enough, is robust enough to go to infinity. Okay, so what you do is rather simple. You take a big R, you take, let's say, R C minus, R C plus, you have your centers, and you try to solve with a large R, with R, with any given R, and then to pass R to infinity. Now what happens? That of course you may have, you can first try by taking the minimal geodesics, connecting these two points. Okay, this can be done. But then you realize that the minimal geodesic will go to infinity when R goes to infinity. So when you let this radius diverge, you will just find nothing. Okay? Why? Because the minimal arc will not interact with the centers. So we try again, and we find, we use the topology of the configuration space to find a second arc which has Morse index 2 as a geodesic. So it's not minimal, has one direction of negativity of the quadratic form. Okay, and this is the good one. Okay, this will be the one which will remain when R goes to infinity. Okay, so we consider this fixed endpoint. We take, for example, the action. We take some interval, and we use some relation with the Morse index and properties, the qualitative properties of the solution, to prove that the minimal distance to the singular set stay both bounded below and above uniformly when R goes to infinity. And this fact is related with some remark already done by Tanaka about the scattering angle of one center and the Morse index, the relation about the scattering angle, the Morse index, and the presence or absence of collisions. Okay, so finally we understand that in this case, to prove this theorem, we have to be more precise and to find one particular solution of the fixed end problem that has two properties. One is a bound on the Morse index, and the other is an estimate on the action. Okay, when we have done this with a lot of work, that will be a talk by Boscaggini about this technique, one can prove that there is the limit when R goes to infinity.
Sorry, but here alpha should be... Okay. different from 2. Alpha different from 2.
Alpha is between 1 included and 2 excluded. Oh, this in fact, when alpha is larger than 2, there are no such orbits for given. It's completely different as a. Okay, now let me elaborate on the connection with the construction of collisionless complex trajectories and semi-conjugacy with the Bernoulli shift. And then I have to go back to the planar case. Okay, so now we consider the planar case, again, with the same class of potentials and a number of centers, which will be at least 3 for our purposes. And again, now we have our Hamiltonian systems, and we consider negative energy trajectories. So H will be a negative number. Note that we can scale the energy and put it equal to minus 1, for example, and then introduce a parameter epsilon, which will be the maximal distance of the centers from the common barycenter. Okay. So one can think of this as a problem which is, has in the limit the parabolic problem, because when epsilon goes to 0, when the center collapses into the barycenters, making the centers collapse into the origin is the same as letting H go to 0 from the negative side, so negative 0. So in the limit we find the parabolic problem. Okay, and now I go back to the example I was trying to explain before. Now we consider a partition of the center, a non-trivial partition in 2 non-empty sets. And we know that there is a parabolic trajectory that has 2 given normalized configuration and cuts the centers in the two sets. Okay, and this will be our way of describing the inner dynamics, the dynamics that holds within a large circle. What happens outside? Outside, we will consider 2 neighboring points in this circle of radius r. And well, again, you see, now we can think that the epsilon is very close to the radial potential, 1 over r to the alpha. Okay, because you are outside a large circle, and then there will be an arc connecting these 2 points, which is very close to a piece of an almost degenerate ellipsis. Okay, epsilon here is really a very small parameter and acts as a perturbation. Okay, so for every pair P0 and P1, which are very close, you have a unique arc that connects the 2 with this given energy and with its length. Okay, so this can be, for example, proved by inverse function. Okay. Now, saying that epsilon is small is the same as saying that r is large. So you can, if you prefer, you can fix r and make the center collapse, or vice versa. Is okay. And then So what you do? You consider the a pair P1 and P2 and one given set of centers, and you can connect P1 and P2 with at least one trajectory, minimal trajectory, and then one realizes that the problem is now to find appropriate pairs of points on the circle where the two arcs, the inner and the outer arcs, intersect with equal velocity. Okay, and this can be translated, in fact, into again a variational problem. So take a number of pairs on this circle, and consider as a function the sum of the length of the alternate inner and outer arcs for a given sequence of a partition of the center. So you give a sequence of partitions, and then you fix in any possible way pairs of points, and you consider as a function the total length of this arc. In general, the derivative will not match, but then you have a function which depends on a finite number of points, and if you extremize with respect to all possible points, all possible choice of points, you will find as extremely the condition that the derivative matches. Okay, so you can in fact use this closed parabolic inner arc alternated with kind of close, of degenerate ellipses to prove the existence of a subsystem which is semi-conjugate to the Bernoulli shift for the n center problem with small negative energies. Okay, and just to make this statement more precise, let me remind what the Bernoulli shift is. We have a finite set in a metric space. For us, this finite set is the possible non-trivial partitions of the set of centers, and we endow the set of B-infinite sequences of elements of this metric space with this trivial metric. And so here we have a set, a metric space, and we have an homeomorphic on that, which is just the shift of one position in the sequence. And we find a dynamical system which is kind of prototypical for the chaotic dynamics. And in this case, we can see very easily that all periodic sequences are periodic points, and that these are countably dense in the set of in the metric set space, and that this dynamical system has a high sensitivity with respect to initial condition and positive topological entropy. So whenever we can relate a subsequence of a given dynamical systems to this Bernoulli shift, we will speak about the occurrence of symbolic dynamics with set of symbols S. Okay, so this is just to make precise the statement that the two dimensions, the small energy, negative energy, end center problem has chaotic subsequence. Okay, about the end center problem, let me just remind a number of very fundamental papers and fundamental studies, starting from that of Bolotin in 1984, and then there is a book of Klein and Knauf, and many papers about chaotic motion, about various kinds, type of motions in some particular cases. Okay, how much time? Okay, so let me just use this 5 minutes to say something about parabolic trajectories for the n-body problem. Okay, because the n-center problem is in any case an approximation, and as an approximation loses one very important feature of the n-body problem, which is the scale invariance. Okay, and for parabolic trajectory, scale invariance is a fundamental property. Okay, so let's go now in any dimension, and we consider a positive potential V, which is homogeneous of degree minus alpha in its globality, okay? And we try to understand what are the parabolic trajectories. Parabolic trajectories for now are those for which the energy, the total energy is zero, and there is a definite behavior of the velocity, a vanishing behavior of the velocity at infinity, because this, okay. And again, we can try to study the problem of finding parabolic trajectories having two given configurations. And then it turns out that not all configurations are allowed, but only central configurations. Okay. And this can be done through a monotonicity formula, but I will skip this this one, okay? Monotonicity formula can prove that in any case the end points for the normalized configurations are central configuration. And now we are interested in parabolic trajectories which have some more properties. In particular, they are minimizers of the actions in any possible time interval. This means that they are also minimizers for the Jacobi matrix. Okay. And these are the analog of the parabolic trajectories for the n-body n-center problem I tried to elaborate. It is important to note that in general they don't exist. Okay, in general they don't exist. Portaluri will, I think, report about the Morse index of parabolic trajectory and their applications in Celestial mechanics. Okay, and then how can we detect the presence, which is very unlikely of a minimal parabolic trajectories. Okay, well, let's give these two directions, which are central configuration, and let's consider a geodesics that connects the two. And then there are two possibilities. Either the geodesic is bound to pass through the zero, which is the total collision, or not. Okay, so this can be expressed as a focal property of the origin, or not. Well, in the first case, we talk about inner minimizers, and in the second case, we talk about outer minimizers. The rays will have to pass. The minimal rays have to pass to the origin, or they will go around the origin. Okay, and then you classify the potentials in this way. And the theorem is that only at the boundary of these two classes of potentials you can find a minimal parabolic trajectory. Okay, so it is the boundary of something. There are some interesting consequences of that, but I will not tell you. So, thank you very much.